yourself. Hello. Yeah?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Good, good. So, are you enjoying these kinds of lectures? Is it easier for
yes,
you?
Yes, ma'am.
At least we are not wasting our time. That makes good, isn't it? So, I'll just start my lecture now. Most of you, I think, many of you have joined it. So will you, I think you should mute yourself so that you can hear me clearly. If you have to ask any question in between, you can unmute and then ask me the questions, okay? So I think that is easier. That is what all are telling me to do. So to begin with my lecture, just a minute, I'll admit three more people are waiting. Let me admit all and then we'll start the lecture. Okay, so today's lecture is on endodontic surgery. As you know, endodontics as a subject deals with the root and the tooth and the pulp which is inside it. So actually all the procedures that we do are in fact under surgical only, because surgery by word means removal of any of the tissues from the body. So that way it becomes a surgical procedure throughout. But apart from that, in spite of us having a oral surgery as a specific branch, we still have a subject called as endodontic surgery. The reason behind this is that we want to deal with the specific area in and around the tooth, and we need to protect the tooth as such. Okay. The whole aim is here right now is to save the tooth. We are supposed to be the people who save the teeth, no matter what. So all attempts done to save the tooth can come under the aid of endodontic surgery. Coming to the definition of endodontic surgery, it's a surgical procedure which is related to the problem of the pulp or the periodontally involved tooth requiring amputation and endodontic therapy. So this was given by Engel, who is supposed to be one of the pioneers in our endodontics. And he said that all the surgeries which we are doing in and around the tooth are considered as endodontic surgery. Then came Franklin Wien, who said that removal of tissues other than the content of the canal space to retain the tooth with pulpal and periapical involvement should be considered as endodontic surgery. Okay. Sorry. So what was the rationale? The rationale is that though you know that we are doing root canal treatment to remove any infection from the tooth, but at times the infection spreads into the periapical area, that is in the periodontium. So no matter what you put into the canal, even if you put medicaments, even if you try to irrigate, it is very difficult for us to clean the surrounding periodontal or periapical area. So in such cases, the only option that remains to us is that we have to surgically lift the flap and reach the reach that periapical area through opening of the port. This will help us to restore the periodontium to its original state of biologic balance and functional health. The main objective of our endodontic surgery is also to place a proper seal between the periodontium and root canal foramen. Throughout the lectures that you have heard on endodontic surgery, you must have heard that you have to remove, that the root canal space is infected. There is infection in the root canal space. And you have also heard that it is next to impossible to clear every single microorganism from the root canal space. So there are some microorganisms which remain persistent in the canal. So in that case, what happens is that we have to at least try to seal those microorganisms inside the root canal and prevent their re-entry into the periapical space. So when we are doing a surgery and we are exposing the root canal, the apex of the root canal, what we are trying to do is that we are trying to remove the infection in the periapical area. At the same time, the root which is exposed, we are trying to seal that root properly from the periapical area so that the infection doesn't reach the periapex again. Okay. So what are the indications for the root canal surgery? First indication for the root canal surgery is need for surgical drainage. For first, that is elimination of the toxins or elevation of the pain. What is happening is, especially in today's times when we are saying that there should not be any aerosol and and you should do minimum treatment to the patient, because dentists as such are supposed to be in the front line for getting exposed to the infection. So in that case, it is very important that we at least elevate the patient's pain or try to minimize the infection. So in that case, what we are doing is we are trying to remove the toxins by a surgical process, that is incision and drainage, or by another method that is called as trephination. So according to the DCI's guideline and all the guidelines given by the Dental Council and the IDA, what we are doing now is that any patient who enters the dental clinic, we are trying to remove the infection or at least minimize the infection in the patient's mouth by doing incision and drainage or giving them antibiotics. We are not instituting any root canal treatment. Also, this is because the Government of India has given us a directive that there should be no procedure done which forms a aerosol. And as you know that we use a air rotor handpiece for the patient, and if we use an air rotor handpiece, there is a lot of aerosol that is generated, and this may spread the infection not only to you but in the whole of the operatory. Right now the status is that each patient entering your clinic, whether he's tested positive or negative, is considered as a COVID positive patients, and therefore we are taking all precautions not to spread this infection further. So the next indication is when your non-surgical endodontic treatment, that is whether you do a single sitting root canal treatment or you do a multiple sitting root canal treatment. If for some reason you are unable to complete the treatment as is required by the by whatever indications were there, and you are unable to reach the periapical area, in that case, you have no other options but to go in for an endodontic surgery. This can be seen visually in the in the X-ray as a obviously inadequate filling, or apparently adequate filling. That is, sometimes the filling, the when you see a X-ray, you see that a proper root canal filling is done. But this could just be a radiographic picture. There may be an additional canal hiding behind that canal, or there may be some other lateral canal present there which is infected and the patient is getting recurring infection. Or third, cases where there is a persistent post-procedural discomfort. At times, during your endodontic therapy, what happens is that because of your aggressive treatment or because of the irrigant going into the periapical area, or sometimes even the infection extending into the periapical area, in spite of a proper root canal treatment, the patient doesn't get relief from pain. In such instances, you have to do what is now considered as the what you have to do next is that you have to clean the periapical area mechanically. Okay, sometimes in a root canal you see calcific metamorphosis of the pulp space, though this is no longer a valid indication because we do not consider that there is complete calcification of the pulp space ever. With the use of microscopes and better instruments today, we are able to bypass any calcific metamorphosis seen in the pulp space. But earlier, this was not so. So, this is considered as one of the indications for surgical treatment. Wherever you see a completely calcified canal and you do not have a place to, and you feel that you will not be able to reach the periapical area, then it is better to leave the calcification inside the canal and approach the tooth from the periapical area. Okay. Here, one thing I would like to tell you that if there is such a kind of calcific metamorphosis throughout the pulp chamber, then you must understand that nature is a better obturating material than all the obturating materials available in the with us in the operatory today. Like if there is calcification of the pulp chamber, that calcification will be definitely better than any gutta percha you want to put into the canal space. So in such a case, leave the calcific metamorphosis in the pulp space and reach the periapical area. Second is the procedural errors. For procedural errors, this also you have heard that there is sometimes separation of the instrument in the pulp chamber, or instrument fragmentation is there, and that is this instrument which is separated inside the root canal may obstruct your approach to the periapical area, and if you are unable to remove this instrument, then you have to approach the periapical area surgically. Sometimes while doing preparation, biomechanical preparation of the pulp space, you end up creating a ledge inside the canal. This ledge may be non-negotiable and it might lead to difficulty in reaching the periapical area. In all such cases, you do have to go in for a surgical procedure. Okay, so third is the root perforation. Sometimes when you are doing a biomechanical preparation, you might end up perforating the root because of your improper angulation or because of overzealous cleaning of the root canal space. And such root perforations might end up being a source of constant leakage into the root canal or into the periapical area, and this might also lead into failure of your root canal treatment. Therefore, it is important that you do a surgical sealing of this kind of perforation. Or you may have end up doing a symptomatic overfillings. You must have seen on the Facebook, at times there are overfillings done into the peripheral area, some of which might reach it to the mandibular canal, or some may enter into the sinus also, maxillary sinus also. So these overfillings end up causing a foreign body reaction for the patient, and a constant source of pain to the patient. So such cases, you have to do a surgical opening of the periapical area. Fifth is the anatomic variation, that is root dilaceration or apical root fenestration. Dilaceration, as you know, is the acute angulation of the root canal. We do not as such have a instrument now, or a root canal instrument, or a rotary root canal instrument, which can enter at an angle into the apex of the root. So such cases, there is only one alternative, that is you have to do a root canal surgical. Then at times, if you have a large periapical lesion, you have done a root canal filling and the periapical radiolucency is not healing, or you feel that it must be something else other than the routine periapical infections which you see. And if you are in doubt, it is always better to do a biopsy and check if there is anything not so good in the periapical area. Here again, the only choice is endodontic surgery. And lastly is the corrective surgery. This is actually one of the most important indications where we are doing endodontic surgery nowadays. First is the root resorptive defects. If there is resorption, you have seen, not the internal resorption. If there is an external resorption, then in those cases, you have to reach the root resorptive defects through an endodontic surgical approach. Or there is root caries deep below the bony level. Then how will you do the filling? You will have to do a endodontic surgical procedures. Root resections. When only one root is infected, it has a large periapical infection and it's not healing at all, then rather than extracting the whole tooth, what we are doing is that we are removing only that infected root and leaving the rest. Suppose it's a maxillary first molar, there are three roots there, isn't it? So if there are three roots there, then why should you extract the whole tooth if only one root is infected? Suppose the mesiobuccal root is infected, we will open the surrounding area, then we will just extract the mesiobuccal root there and leave the other two roots which are strong enough to maintain the tooth in the mouth. The second is hemisection. Hemisection is generally done in the lower first molar, or second molar also you can do. In lower first molar, you know that there are two roots. One is the mesial and one is the distal root. Suppose your mesial root is infected, the distal root is firm inside the tooth. Then what we do is that we cut the tooth from the occlusal surface itself into two halves. And we remove the buccal, the mesial half, and we save the distal half. If the mesial half is infected, if the distal half is infected, then we remove the distal half and save the mesial half. So what you are doing is that you are making the single molar into two pieces. That is why it is called as hemisection. And if you are removing that particular section and just extracting it and making it a molar again, it is called as hemisection. The next word is bicuspidization. Sometimes both the roots are good, but the in-between furcation area, there is a lot of loss of bone and the tooth is getting infected again and again. Maybe you had perforated in the furcation area or some reason for that. So in that cases, you know that both the roots are good, only the furcation area is giving you problem again and again. In this case, again, you do a hemisection, but you do not remove either of the roots. You maintain one of the root into the, you maintain both the roots inside the patient's mouth, but they are treated as now two separate teeth. So one molar becomes two cuspid, that is two premolars. So we call it as bicuspidization. So this is a very important topic and it does come as a short note for you. Okay, so remember this. So any surgical procedure which you do will have some contraindication, isn't it? So for contraindication, first is the first contraindication that you will always have is that systemic disorders, cardiovascular, leukemia, neutropenia, uncontrolled diabetes, recent cardiac surgery, immunocompromised patient, and so many others. Now we can add COVID also. So in all these cases, you cannot do an endodontic surgery without a prior leave from the physician, approval from the physician. He has to clarify it first. Okay. Then running out of time. I'll have to upgrade it. No? 1 second. This is coming. I upgraded it.
नहीं ना 8.5 मिनट्स हैं बाकी
speak and tell them send me the details. I'm sorry, there's some problem with it. I cannot upgrade it to the I'm just telling you. But I cannot change the slide also right now. Yeah. So where we were? We had those systemic problems. Then if the patient is on any medications, you have to take the clearance of the physician. If the patient is having some psychologically traumatized patient who is scared of the surgery and all, so you do get patients like that, you have to take prior clearance from his treating physician. Local contraindications are definitely there. Suppose there are anatomical difficulties like surgically inaccessible area, which could be this. If you have a lesion in the maxillary palatal root, it is difficult to reach that area. Sometimes the roots are very short or they are very long. Very short means if you are opening the root and the root is very short, you are going to cut the root again and there may be some bone loss. So ultimately the amount of root remaining will be very less, which would end up creating problems for the long-term life of the tooth. if there is poor bone support or if the cortical plates are missing in all these times, you have to reconsider your decision of doing a surgery. Patients with limited mouth opening, for obvious reason, you cannot do a surgery. Bony tori or exostosis, it is very difficult to reach any areas where there are bony tori or exostosis. And ultimately, you are doing this tooth to save the tooth. If in the end the tooth cannot be restored to its normal occlusal level or its aesthetic level, why are you doing the surgery? Anatomic considerations are there, like if it is in close proximity to the nasal floor or the maxillary sinus. If your cortical plates are very thin, then you might end up doing a fenestration or dehiscence, both of which are not good for the prognosis of the tooth. So you do not do this. Or if you are in a close proximity of a neurovascular bundle, you don't want to end up having a patient with neurovascular deficiency, isn't it? So it is best avoided doing surgery in that area. Periodontally, if there is a periodontal pocket bony dehiscent where there is lack of attached gingiva, you do not do these kind of surgery. Prosthetically, if you cannot restore this tooth with a proper crown root ratio and a good crown margin, it is not viable to do this kind of surgery. Aesthetically, if it is going to leave a scar or amalgam tattoo, both of these things were happening earlier. With nowadays, with our kind of surgical suturing materials the restoring materials we have, we do not have these kind of problems anymore. In general, is medically compromised patient and emotionally distressed patient. This is the surgical instrument kit which you have, and this should be displayed there. Of course, with COVID coming in, everything has changed. Nowadays, now we will not be able to do anything without a proper PPE kit which we should have before starting any patient. The classification for these instruments was given by Kim, and it is based on the sequence of the instrument used. As you know, it will be examination, incision, elevation, tissue retraction, curettage. This is all taught to you in oral surgery, so I will not go in detail of this. Only we have retrofill carriers and retrofill pluggers too. Seal the apical area of the tooth. We do use some ultrasonic instruments to clean the periapical area. Of course, surgical operating microscope is indicated nowadays because we have better instruments with use of these. These are some of the examination instruments, not going in detail. Incision blades also have been taught to you very well in surgery. So, if you see elevation instrument, on the left side you see the traditional instrument. The microsurgical instruments are much smaller and have a less trauma to the periapical area. You need tissue retraction instruments. You need curettage or curating instruments. You use a microendodontic curettes for it. For osteotomy, that is removal of the bone, you require specific handpieces for this. This the last handpiece is the impact air 45 degree handpiece, which is used so that there is no the air doesn't go into the area, surgical area, and cause problems there. These are the different types of burrs that are used. Then coming to the classification of the endodontic surgery, was given by, you have two types, fistulative and the periradical surgery. The fistulative surgery is incision drainage, cortical trephination, and decompression procedures. Periradicular surgery, apical curettage, root end resection, root end penetration, preparation, and root end filling. Then you have corrective procedures, which are perforation repair, periodontal management like root resection and tooth resection, or intentional replantation and implant surgery. Here the implant surgery is the endodontic implant surgery, not the routine implant surgery. So coming to the last part of my lecture today, the surgical drainage, it is indicated. This is what we are doing all over India, all over the world right now. If the patient is coming with any swelling, pain, abscess, then we are using the incision drainage. What we are doing is we are applying topical anesthesia. The anesthetic used is Mepibicaine. Then we are doing a horizontal incision with number 11 or 12 BP plate at the most fluctuant area. That is how it will start draining. And if it doesn't drain, we also place a drain in that area. This will help open up the incision and it will cause the pulse to drain out. See, you can see it in the picture clearly. So the drains are either you can use a piece of rubber dam, or you can use a iodoform gauze, or you can use a Penrose drain. This is the picture of how a Penrose drain looks like. And a Penrose drain and is sometimes sutured into the area, so there is a constant drainage of whatever fluid